It's what?
I believe it's $695.
Roughly $695, and first year was $95?
$95 or 1%
of their income?
Yeah, whichever is greater.
Okay.
The one question, wasn't there supposed to be like a catastrophic plan for people under a certain age?
Yes.
So for the people you're talking about, oh, I'm never going to get sick, that they could sign up for that, and that's really cheap.
15 years ago, January.
Yeah, the 15 years ago, January, yeah. But that, those are really cheap, aren't they?
Yes. There, it's a catastrophic plan for folks who are under 30, and it is, it's just that. It's sort of this high deductible catastrophic plan that has less robust coverage than a bronze plan would, but it's certainly available for those younger folks.
So what I'm understanding, back to the company, it's going to be very, very important as an employer to really have your documentation on the declines and the percentages to make sure you're offering affordable care. And do we have any guidelines when it will be determined if it's 30 hours for a large employer? Will that be coming in 2014, the givens that we need to follow, or?
It's out there now.
Yeah, it's, from my understanding, it's out there now, because that's what I've been receiving from my insurance broker, is letting us know that it's classified as anyone that's working 30 hours or more. So that's who's been providing me with that information currently. So you could also check, currently working with an insurance broker?
Okay.
Is check with their current insurance broker on it. Now, a question that I have that kind of builds a little bit of what we were talking about before, about these, right now, the small business could set up an account on there and say we would put in X amount, and then people would pick up another percent from there. And that could be eventually expanded, you say, in 2017 to any size employee.
In 2016, the definition of small business will go to 100. So at that point, then, anybody with 100 or fewer employees would be eligible to go through the shop portion of the exchange, because they're defined as a small business. And then subsequently wouldn't be subject to the penalties and things like that, because they're considered a small business. Then in 2017, the state legislature and the governor could decide on a different definition. But federal law dictates what that is up until 2017.
And all these premiums will still be eligible for pre-tax dollars on their paychecks?
Yes, yep.
Is your Social Security going to be considered income for this, or no?
Yes.
Okay, what about your, like, let's say you've got a union pension plan. Is that going to be considered income?
I'm sure.
Okay, what about the, let's say you've got your IRA, where you've got to take some of dollars out every year because you hit a certain age? That's going to be considered income?
Yep.
Okay, so basically, all your, I mean, not your assets, though, I take it, not your house, not your 401K plan until you take it out, or anything like that. So all that will be considered income, so you have to do that every year and give them that, all that information.
Up to 65.
No, 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 because at 70, you get to draw out your IRA.
No, 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 because once a person is 65, they're eligible for Medicare, and Medicare is separate. So all the stuff we're really talking about really only matters up to 65.
Except if your spouse is over 65 and you're not.
Right.
She don't get it.
I'm getting locked out of this because of his RMD, his Social Security, stuff like that. But my own personal policy that I got through Blue Cross Blue Shield is going from $232 up to $432, because they're now mandating that I have maternity coverage, well, baby coverage, childhood dental, stuff that I don't need, but they're doubling my policy. This is affordable healthcare?
But the catastrophic care that you're talking about, that's for these young people, doesn't that have to cover all those things, too? I mean, because, no? Well, then, it.
What's considered catastrophic?
I can't remember that part, but there's some things that were added to catastrophic. I can't remember what's in there and isn't. I haven't baked that part of it, attention to that part of catastrophic.
But catastrophic, if I understand it, is just for major medical. Isn't that what you used to consider major medical? Like, if you go in the hospital, you break a leg, something like that. Okay, so if you're offering an 80-20 to a young person for catastrophic care, but yet you've got these mandates for, like you said, maternity, blah, 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 all the way down the line. I think there's 20 of them. why wouldn't you offer that same catastrophic care to anybody?
This is what Congress and the President passed.
Well, I'm just saying, I mean, maybe that's, you know, maybe that would be a helpful thing, is that they just offered it.
It's a point, you know.
It's a fair point.
In our state, if you don't have insurance, are you denied if you go into an ER? Or is, do they have to?
They have to take you? There's no state.
In the state of Minnesota.
Well, isn't that even federal?
It's federal.
Is it federal?
Which is the uncompensated care that he was talking about that is going to be decreased, which helps contribute to lowering costs along with market competition. And fair market competition.
Well, I know we're kind of getting to the end. Originally, I said we were going to go to 11:30, now it's 10 to 12. So
I was 10 minutes late.
Which I understand.
Because of my little detour through these.
I just have one question.
Sure. Right.
In the legislature last year, when you were passing the Medicaid expansion and you wanted the Affordable Care Act in there, there was an amendment in the Senate asking that all legislators be put on the Health Care Act in the health care bill. That was, during conference, omitted. So when you pass these bills, there was nothing there about that. Would you be willing, when you come back in, you know, this fall and whatever, to put an amendment saying that all the body, the Senate, everybody goes on the Affordable Care Act?
Well, you know what, it's interesting because that would be unfair to large employers and other employees. There are going to be some employers who can save money by going onto the health exchange.
I'm asking you as an individual, the Senate and the House members become part of the Affordable Care Act.
Correct, but as a state being a large employer, I don't qualify for the health exchange. And so what I'm saying is we would set up dual standards by giving me the opportunity to and not giving large employers the opportunity.
Yeah, you do, because President Obama waived that subsidy thing. Now the legislators in Congress are getting the same subsidies, are getting a subsidy. They're getting the, like it would be like a employer contribution. They're gonna get that. So no, that's not correct.
When you say the employer contribution.
The taxpayer, the taxpayer contribution.
So you're saying they would be subsidized.
They would not be subsidized. They would get the same plan as anybody else, like her over here, you know, saying, well, this is what I make and blah, blah, blah. So that's what you would be. What I'm asking is just pretty, you know, straightforward. Are you, you know, would you be part of it? Would you put an amendment in there saying, let's vote on this?
If it's fair, if it's treating everyone the same across the board, because the government is an employer, and if it's going to be an advantage for the employer, if it's an advantage for the employer, I would not be supporting it if we can't give the same advantages to private businesses. I'm saying consistency. I would have no problem personally having my plan off the exchange.
Mm-hmm.
I would have no problem as a personal person. I would not have a problem taking it.
Okay.
But when I take a look at being consistent across the board, last thing I want to do is put a rule out there to giving advantages to one group of employers and not another. Group.
No, they would not get any more. They would not get any different subsidies than anybody else out there.
So
if you're making $130,000 on your job, you're not. Let's say you were. I mean,
Say I was paying getting
$130,000. Insurance companies, a lot of them are nonprofit. Okay, so let's say you're making $130,000 out there. You're not going to get a subsidy. Okay, mm-hmm. But in the Congress right now, if you're making $130,000, the government is still subsidizing your insurance.
So they
want to take that away. They want to get them out of it and say, get over here, you pass this bill, you know, and you be a part of this. I'm asking you, would you be a part of it?
I'm trying to understand because it sounds like what you're saying is that right now, Congress, they are getting the federal government pays for their insurance, and what you're saying is that they should go to the exchange.
Where they would not get that kind of subsidy.
So the government would no longer pay for it, and instead of having the government paying for their insurance, the individual would pay for their insurance.
Now you want an employed individual to pay the entire piece of.
Well, I want them to pay what, I want them to pay.
The 9.5%.
Yeah, they could.
Like me, what we have to do.
Congress passed it that they were going to be subject to the ACA. Problem is that everybody wouldn't end up for because they aren't well subject, or because they make $130,000, they wouldn't get the subsidies. So what happened was the executive branch under Obama decided to say, we're giving you the subsidies to the Congress.
And that's the same for the state of Minnesota, you know, so.
You know what?
The state legislators are different though, because many of them have other jobs.
Then why did they try to pass it and then they took it out? If it wasn't going to affect them, why did they bother taking it out? They took it out in conference. Roger Chamberlain and the Senate and other Senate members put it in as an amendment and they took it out. I mean, if it wasn't going to affect them, why did they take it out?
Did it affect the staff as well? Because the staffs are the ones that really get hit the worst.
It might very well have.
Because the thing is that
it might very well have, just like it affects the small company who has 50 employees. It also affects them on the bottom line too.
I don't know, you just described for a small employer sounded pretty sweet actually.
It sounds like the promise of
I was amazed how good what you just described was.
But they should look at, instead of number of employees, they should look at CEO paycheck.
Right.
How much a CEO makes to determine.
Yeah. Let's think about how much
President Obama made to the state.
Are there any companies that are exempt from any of this?
Big businesses.
The self-insureds. I know the unions that have got that are providing their insurance plans are exempt from certain portions of it. I don't know who else is in it. You know, I haven't followed as much what the federal guidelines have been versus what's been happening on the MNSure itself in terms of that rolling out. Those are more federal issues than they are state issues. Except where I understand 2017, when we get to decide, you know, when we can decide, you know, which size of business can participate in the exchange. And I'm very interested in hearing more on that from people, because to me it sounds like for a number of businesses it might give them better opportunities than they have now. I think if, you know, particularly what was described earlier, for a business to be able to go online and say, we'll pay X amount, let the employees figure out the rest of it from there.
It sounds kind of like
a big win-win that could really help out any size employer down the road. And that's where I kind of get excited about. But I'd be, you know, we've got a couple of years on it, so I'd be very interested in hearing other businesses take a look at it and see what their thoughts are on it. That would be something I could support.
Well, COBRA basically worked the same as with the exchanges. Someone leaves your employment.
Yeah, COBRA will still exist, but folks will have another option, of course, just to go and buy a policy that's not affiliated with that group plan that they've been in, because it's guaranteed issue now. It can't be denied any an insurance policy after January 2014. So I think a lot of folks, they retain their COBRA coverage because they had insurance but couldn't get insurance in the individual market because they had a pre-existing condition or something like that. So COBRA will still exist, but folks have another option now.
Because COBRA is really expensive.
Right.
Yes.
Right, so it may be a better financial decision to not take COBRA and just buy something off the individual market, or see if you qualify for some financial assistance on MNSure or something like that.
Will there be additional paperwork then to follow through? You know, because this, you know, you've been contributing, and when they do their taxes and so forth, and what if they choose not to opt into the COBRA and they don't go to the exchange? It probably sounds a little bizarre, but I.
Not your employer, so I'm not sure.
Well,
that would,
your portion. I mean, we can send out the COBRA letter.
She'll probably have to do that.
You know, standard. But I'm just.
But they can waive COBRA now, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. We send out a formal letter.
Yeah. So that's.
So
but I'm just saying.
That continues. That,
you know.
Yeah. That due to
who's gonna? They'll police it through their returns then.
Right. Yeah. At that point, if you offer COBRA coverage under the law, if you still have to and you fulfill that, that's fine. But then it's really on an individual to understand for themselves how they want to satisfy the individual mandate, right? If they want to satisfy it by taking COBRA coverage, that's fine. If they want to buy an individual plan on the individual market outside of insurance, that's fine. they want to go on insurance and buy a plan. It's on the individual.
See, the thing with that is, and it sounds great when you're dealing with adults, but if you're dealing with young people, they just don't want to be bothered, and they don't want to hear the facts, and they don't care about the government, and you know what I'm saying? So as an employer, it's really hard to chase people down and make them understand.
Well,
how this
I could
is going to work.
I could make you flip out because I can say the only answer to that is universal health care.
Mm, you bet.
I mean, really, truly, and I know
right,
that.
Just take it off from
no,
the
no,
taxpayer.
No,
let's
no,
let all those workers
no, but,
all retire.
No, but I guess what I'm getting at is that as soon as you start saying you don't want to deal with individual responsibility, then that's the only way those.
It's
people
not that I don't want to deal with it. Yeah. It's people don't step up and want to take care of themselves. They're too used to your universal. They want the government to come and take them from point A to point B. You know, my job is not to babysit you. Mm-hmm. You as a productive citizen mm-hmm. should be able to make these choices and return things on a timely basis. That's my point. It's not that I don't care. Mm-hmm. I'm doing my portion, but I wish everyone else would do theirs.
We are at noon. I have the room reserved only until noon today.
Okay.
So I thank everybody for coming today. I appreciate it. John, thank you so much for coming today. You provided quite a bit of information that very much helped out me. I appreciate the additional expertise that you brought that we didn't have a background on.
And this administration website is actually really good to visit that. I would just encourage you guys to Google that and look it up. They have documents that really get into these really specific questions that we talked about today that, I mean, it's from those folks I think are reliable sources of information. So I would just encourage folks to look there as well.
There have been some questions earlier about whether the information was reliable or such change. Do you think all the bugs have been worked out of the programs that are on the
information? All the numbers.
Yeah, so for the informational portion of our website, so right when you arrive and if you click on information and look, that stuff is certainly reliable and you can take that to the bank. To the extent you move through the application process, you know, there's been a couple of hiccups since we started, you know, 18 days ago, and so we're a young enterprise and continually making it better. And I think someday it will be just as slick as Amazon, as they say. So, but for now, yeah, we're working through that. Over 6,000 people have completed an application. 3,700 people are on their way to get insurance. So, you know, folks are finding what they need, but we certainly are going to do better as we move forward.
Are those 3,700 actually put their application in and finished it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.